to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3. For the past few weeks, I've been preaching a series of messages on understanding our identity in Christ. And out of that series of messages, we've been looking at the first three chapters of Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus. And as we're looking at this, you'll find that Paul talks about being in Christ, and he talks about being in him numerous times. And I believe that a key part of our Christian life is coming to understand our spiritual identity, who we are in Christ, what God has done in us, and what he's made us, and what he's called us to be. And so my hope and prayer is that as I've been preaching on this, that you've been growing confident in what God has done in and for you and is currently even doing in your life so that you can glorify God and glorify the Lord with your works and with your witness so that you can be a powerful testimony and exalt the Lord God. So just to kind of recap and bring this all together, because Lord willing, I believe, unless God moves on me to extend it, this is going to be the final message in this part of this series. But we began with looking at chapter 1 and about our spiritual blessings. Aren't you glad that God has blessed you? Anybody blessed out there this morning? We are a blessed people. Matter of fact, sometimes we get pretty grumpy and gripeful and all that type of stuff, but we need to remember the poorest person here in America lives like a king compared to people in other places of this world. You know, we have no idea what real poverty is. The poorest person in our nation is a king compared to what many other people, other places in the world. So we are a blessed people, and we as Christians and believers, we're blessed spiritually, and God has done awesome things in our lives. And I believe you got to know what those blessings are to understand your identity. And then we also looked at how to get revved up. And we saw that God wants to bless us, and there are spiritual revelations that God gives to us that we need to maintain, that we need to hold on to. How do you know God wants to show you some things? He wants to show you some things. He wants to show you Christ so that you come to know him more deeply. But there are other spiritual revelations that God manifests to us and shows us through his word and by his spirit that we've got to hold on to. And that's part of understanding, again, our identity in Christ. Last week, we preached a message out of chapter 2 on his workmanship. And we saw that that there is a work of God that's going on in our lives. How many are glad that God's working on you? He's still working on me. He's still working on you. He's chipping off some rough edges. He's sharpening some of us up, and he's polishing off some of our rough spots. Because just like in the temple, they built that temple. But one of the things I mentioned last week is when they built the temple, the Bible says that they did not work on those stones on the temple site. There was no sound of a hammer or a chisel or any type of instrument on the temple site. That means at the quarry, they went and worked on those stones, got them shaped where they were supposed to be, and then brought them to the temple. And you know what? They set them right in place, and they fitted them together. I mean, so God is working on us so that he can fit us into his church so that we can be the people that God calls us to be. And so we come now to chapter 3. And in chapter 3, we're going to look at a few things that I believe Paul tells us are also key for us to understand our true spiritual identity. And this morning I want to preach on God's mystery and his might. Because in chapter 3, Paul talks about the mystery of God that he had elaborated on briefly in the first part of Ephesians. And then he goes on to talk about the power of God, God's might. And how many know that there is a powerful thing that God wants to understand about that, that relates to our spiritual identity this morning? So let's look at God's mystery and God's might from Ephesians chapter 3. And I'm going to open up with the first 7 verses, and then I'm going to refer to different parts of chapter 3 as we get into this. I'm reading from the New King James Version. Paul says, "For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ for you Gentiles, if indeed you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which was given to me for you, how that by revelation he made known to me the mystery as I have briefly already written, by which when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, as it has now been revealed by the Spirit to his holy apostles and prophets, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of the promise in Christ through the gospel, of which I became a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given to me by the effective working of his power." Now let's pause there and look at several things that Paul deals with in Ephesians chapter 3. And first of all, we're going to look at this mystery thing that Paul talks about. It's key to us understanding what this is going on here and what Paul is dealing with here. So the first thing I want you to see, and some of the notes I believe on the back of your bulletins if you want to follow along, is that God has revealed mysteries by His Spirit. God has revealed some powerful mysteries to us, and He does this by the Holy Spirit, by the Spirit of God. I read a story about a mystery lover once who went to find his place at the theater. That was the opening night of a play that was being done there. But the problem was his seat was way, way in the back of the theater. He was really far away from the stage. And this guy loved mystery plays. He loved those things. And he was a little down that, you know, he got stuck way back in the back. So he called for an usher and he whispered to the usher. He said, "I just love a good mystery. And I've been anxiously anticipating this opening of this play, but in order to fully, you know, follow along the clues and enjoy this play, I got to watch this thing up close. I've got to see this mystery taking place. And look how far away I am. I'm always stuck here in the back." He said, "Can you get me a better seat? I'll give you a handsome tip." So the usher nods and says he'll be back very shortly. And looking forward to this large tip, the usher went and spoke to the people in the box office and hoping to find some closer tickets, and with just 3 minutes left till the curtain time, he found an unused ticket at the will call window, and so he snatched it up and brought it into the man who was in the back of the theater, and he whispers, "Follow me." So the usher led the man down the center aisle, down the row, proudly points out an empty seat right in the middle, just up close. I mean, one of the best seats in the house that you could get for this murder mystery play that's going on. And so the guy says, "Thanks so much. This seat is perfect. It's the best seat I've ever had." And he hands the usher a quarter. The usher looked down at the quarter. He then leaned over and whispered, "The butler did it in the parlor with a candlestick." Ruins the mystery for the guy who was looking forward to that. Well, how many know that there is a mystery that God talked about, that Paul referred to, and Paul tells us that there is a mystery that God had that was now being revealed and that had been revealed by the Spirit of God. And I want to talk about that. And this is a key thing, just so you know, before I get into this message, because the world religions of their day, the cults, the pagan belief systems, they worship false gods and idols, and they had these secret type religions and all of these pagan religions had their secret mysteries that they bragged about. And the deeper you got into their pagan cults and their pagan worship, the more knowledge you gain. And there was this false philosophy called Gnosticism that was at work in that world today, which was a search for hidden knowledge. And so the mystery stuff was a big thing in their day. And it's kind of coming back today. We have the people in the New Age movement and all that stuff who want the secret knowledge and all that. Well, Paul is trying to tell them, look, God did have a mystery, but it's not what you think it is. It's not what the world is looking at, but the mystery that God has. And again, a mystery is something that was concealed for a while, but now has been made known. And so God is saying that there is a mystery that He makes known by His Spirit. So follow me along. There's several things I want to point out about this that Paul brings out. First of all, God has made this mystery known. He made it known by His Spirit, but He has made this mystery known. In verse 1 of chapter 1, verse 9 of Ephesians, Paul tells us that, very briefly, God had a plan. And that plan was a mystery that was, up until now, hidden, concealed. It was not revealed. It was not known. People couldn't understand it, couldn't figure it out. Even the people of Israel didn't fully comprehend this. Even though they had glimpses of it in Scripture and the prophets prophesied of it, they kind of scratched their heads because it wasn't fully known exactly what God had in mind with this mystery that He was talking about. The word mystery in Greek comes from a word that literally means a hidden thing, a secret. And in the New Testament, it literally refers to the secret purposes and counsels which God intends to carry out into effect in His kingdom. So it's those things that were before concealed but are now revealed, the purposes and plans of God that He wants to fulfill and carry out about His kingdom. How many know that there is a kingdom that God has? And it's a powerful kingdom. And if you know Jesus, you're in that kingdom right now. You've been brought into that kingdom. And so God's plan, as Paul reveals in chapter 1, is that He wanted to bring all things. Everybody say all things. All things. Paul says God wants to bring all things together in Christ, under Christ, under His authority, under His headship, under His lordship, basically. And when He says all things, those things include, I think He had in mind specifically, angelic beings. Jesus was made higher than the angels. How many know that Jesus is over the angels of God? He is not a brother of one, as one of the cults kind of teaches. Jesus is the Son of God, the unique Son of God. He's exalted above the angels. And He's not only above the heavenly good angels, but He's also over all the fallen angels. You know, they want to do their thing, and they're rebelling right now, and they're trying their stuff. But God says one of the reasons that Jesus came to this earth was so that through His death and resurrection, that He would be exalted above all principality and powers, above all the angelic realms of both good and bad. How many know that Jesus is Lord this morning? Every knee will bow. And what else? Every tongue will confess what? That Jesus is Lord. And so we rejoice in that this morning. We thank God for that. We exult in that. And that's part of that mystery, how God was going to do this. They fully didn't comprehend it. And so through Christ and His death and resurrection, salvation has now been made available to all people who will believe and receive the grace of God that brings them into His kingdom. That was part of that mystery that they really didn't comprehend and fully grasp until Jesus was on the scene and teaching. And even then, guess what? They still didn't get it. Jesus flat out told His disciples while He was walking with them on the earth, told them what was going to take place, told them, and the Bible says they couldn't figure it out. They just kind of put that on the back shelf because that just didn't compute with them. And even after the resurrection, remember that story where two of them were walking on that road to Emmaus, and this Jesus appeared to them, and He starts to explain the things from the Scriptures, and then they started to catch on to it, and their heart was strangely warm. And then when He vanished, they realized who He was because He came to reveal these truths to them. So Jesus came to make this mystery known to us. But there's a second part of this mystery that is just phenomenal, that really does affect most of us here this morning. And that truth is this: God has made Gentile believers into fellow heirs and partakers of the promise. God has made us, the Gentiles, those who are not Jewish by descent, to be fellow heirs and joint participators in this, and we can now be partakers of this promise. Matter of fact, in verse 6, Paul reveals here in Ephesians chapter 3 that this is another part of this mystery, that God had a plan to include those Gentiles, us, into His kingdom, that God just didn't pick Israel to be it and only it. They are a special chosen people, but God also wanted to make a way to include all of His created people. Because how many know that God made us, mankind, in His image? He has a special plan and a place for us. And so God wants to bring it. But that was part of that mystery, how that God was going to bring the Gentiles along with Israel into the promises of God, into being part of the kingdom of God. And so this is the same thing. And Paul even goes on to say, we're now part of the same body. We're part of the church, that God has created this new spiritual Israel. There's still a place for natural Israel, but how many know that we are now the people of God, that we've been brought into the kingdom. We're part of the family of God, and God has still got this special covenant with Israel, His chosen people. Paul talks about this in Romans 9, 10, and 11. You can go study that out. But the Bible also says that we are now the spiritual Israel of God, that we are the people of God. We've been brought into the family of God, that God is now working through us, and we have been brought into this. That was a mystery. And now we are part of that thing that God has demonstrated. And the third aspect of this mystery that God reveals by His Spirit is this truth: God has made ministers to proclaim this. In those first opening verses of Ephesians 3, Paul talks about his ministry and all those different things. But God has this mystery, and He's making it known through preachers, through those who are called into the ministry. There's a funny story about a police officer who arrived at the scene of a murder, and he found that the deceased guy had been drowned in a bathtub that was full of all things, milk. There was another mysterious and bizarre twist to it. There were strawberries scattered all over the body, and a spoon was stuck in one ear. So now they're looking for a serial killer. Some of you will get that in a few seconds. So, you know, there is a mystery that God has. And mysteries are things that are mysterious. They're hard to figure out. They're hard to comprehend at first. But God says that He's raised up Paul. And Paul said, that's why I'm in the ministry. God showed me this mystery as a minister of God to proclaim it, to preach it. And not only him, how many know that God raises up other people? And I'm praying that even out of our church, even out of our midst, that God will raise up others that are called into the ministry, that he lays His hands on and separates them to be pastors and evangelists and missionaries and prophets and apostles, that God raises up and sends out to proclaim his word, because God uses people to share the good news of this mystery. Matter of fact, God still does this even today. Each and every one of those ministers are uniquely gifted by God. We function in unique ways, but let me tell you something. We're all to preach the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We may have different functions and different giftings and do different things because that's how God makes sure that all the ministry is taken care of. But the one thing that all ministers have in common is the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're called to proclaim that good news, to make this mystery known. And I thank God for what he does. And I pray that God will do that, that he'll raise up some. And you may think of yourself, well, I can't do that. But let me tell you something. If God calls you, you can. If God calls you, you can. Second thing comes out of this chapter that I believe is significant is this truth. God has revealed the purpose of this mystery. Look down in verse 10 of chapter 3. Paul says that to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places, according to the eternal purpose which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through faith in him. Therefore, I ask that you do not lose heart at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. Now, let's look at a few things that Paul says here in these verses. What's the significance of it? Well, it is this main point, that God has revealed the purpose of this mystery. The mystery was how God's going to bring all things together into Christ, and that he died on the cross, was raised from the dead. He included us Gentiles into this thing, and we're now part of the family of God. But there's a purpose for God doing all this. And Paul tells us what this purpose is. So as I preach this morning, I want you to understand this purpose. And it's a significant thing, because if we don't get a hold of the purpose, then how many know that we're just going to kind of float around through life, and we're saved, we're going to heaven, but, you know, we're going to miss out on something else that God has in store for us. There is a mystery that goes on. I read a story once. How many of you enjoy the comic strips sometimes? You ever seen Charlie Brown, Peanuts? Remember that? It's still in the papers today. Well, there was one that goes on. I wish that life was easily explained, as that great philosopher of the comic strip, Charlie Brown, once deduced and decided that it was. Lucy is saying to him once, "Life is a mystery, Charlie Brown. Do you know the answer?" So Charlie Brown answers, "Sure. Be kind, don't smoke. Be prompt, smile a lot, eat sensibly, avoid cavities, mark your ballot carefully, avoid too much sun, send overseas packages early, love all creatures above and below, insure your belongings, and try to keep the ball low." And he's just going to go on and on and on and on and on. But before he can get out another thing, Lucy interrupts and says, "Hold real steel, because I'm going to hit you with a very sharp blow to the nose." Yeah, he thinks he's got the mystery figured out, but you know, there's more to that than goes on with this. God has a purpose that we need to understand behind this mystery. What is that purpose? Well, he tells us in verses 10 and 11. First of all, we are to display God's wisdom. We're to display the wisdom of God. This is what Paul says is the purpose of this mystery, first of all. God's done all this, raised us up, saved us, brought into his kingdom through his son, Jesus Christ. He's made this powerful mystery revealed. But the purpose and the reason that God is doing all this is so that he can display the wisdom of God. And you know how he wants to do it? He wants to display it through the church, Paul says. He wants to make manifold the wisdom of God and manifest that through the church. Grace has been given to Paul, and grace has been given to other preachers to proclaim the gospel. And that's why and how we are enlightened to this truth, and we're brought into the gospel of God and into the family of God. And Paul talks about that, but the purpose for that is God wants to display the wisdom of himself and his glory, I believe, to all the world. And he does this through the church. In Ephesians chapter 3, this is where he tells us that this church is going to make known the manifold wisdom of God. Let me read to you the way that Weymouth translates this. He's a Greek scholar. He translates it this way, that the innumerable aspects of God's wisdom. He says the manifold wisdom of God is the innumerable aspects of God's wisdom. It's a way of referring to the awesome wisdom and the glory of God that he reveals to his creation. And to whom is the church to make this known? Well, Paul, if you notice, it says he's to make it known through the principalities and the powers that we are the ones that are displaying this wisdom to. So Paul says the church is to display the manifold wisdom of God, all of that infinite wisdom that he has in his glory. We're to display that to the principalities and powers And that refers to, first of all, the angels of God that are in those heavenly places. How many know that the Bible tells us in several places that the angels desire to look into this salvation thing? They can't quite figure it out because they're sinless, and they are marveled at how this God, who is a holy God, has crafted this plan and design and orchestrated this thing of salvation. It's a mystery to them, and there's other places where Peter even says they desire to look into it. They long to understand this aspect. So God says that we, as we display the wisdom of God in salvation and surrender our lives to Christ and how God works inside of us, he says that we are displaying the glory of God to the very angels. But not only is it something that's displayed to the angels of God, but it's also something that God displays and proclaims to the fallen angels. How many know that there is a devil? And there are demonic spirits and there are fallen angels that are at work trying to hinder what God wants. And so what God says is that through the church, he wants to display his wisdom, his glory, his might, so that it proclaims to all these fallen principalities and demonic beings who God is and how great he is. God wants to show it off inside of us, his church. And how many know that he does that? Every time one of us gets saved, every time one of us gets healed, every time one of us gets filled with the Holy Ghost, every time one of us prays and sees God manifest his power, every time we stand faithful in the midst of persecution and affliction, every time we stand boldly and proclaim the truth of God, we display the wisdom of God, and those angels and fallen angels scratch their heads and say, wow, what is that? It's God at work in his church. That's the purpose of it. We're all part of that. Matter of fact, Paul goes on to say in verse 11 that this was an eternal purpose of God. An eternal purpose. Everybody say eternal. Eternal, that means without beginning, without end. It's always kind of been there in the heart and mind of God. Kenneth Wiest, in his Greek translation, says that this means the purpose of the ages. It was the purpose of the ages that God had to do this. That God had accomplished this and was going to accomplish this through Jesus Christ. You see, both the scriptures and other Jewish writings sometimes tell us that God created the angels actually before he created this earth. The Bible indicates that they rejoiced at the creation of the earth, which tells us that God had already created them and the other spiritual heavenly realm where they existed. However, at some point, there was a rebellion that Scripture indicates that was led by Satan, who was referred to, we believe, as Lucifer at that time. He was cast out of heaven. He came down to earth to tempt mankind that God had created. Man that God had created uniquely in his image, a special creation. See, there are other biblical, even Jewish scholars who believe that at one time, there may have been even in ancient past, another race that God had created on the earth destroyed it because it too became wicked, and that what God is now doing with mankind, with Israel, and with the church is really the culminating act of his eternal plan that he always intended all along. And the reason I say that is because man is a special, created, unique being that is different from anything that God has ever created. Why? Because God made man, he says, in his own image and likeness. There is something about man that is different from anything else that God ever created, even the angels. Something unique, something distinct, that we bear the image of God. Now, whether or not there was a pre-adamic race on the earth or not is not really important. The important truth is that we simply realize this, that man was the culminating act of all that God had made, and it was God's intention throughout all of eternity to display the vastness of his greatness and his wisdom and his glory in the redemption and the exaltation of those who will be in Christ Jesus. That's what God intended from the beginning, so that he could display his manifold wisdom in the church. His wisdom, his glory, who he is, so that he can let it shine, so that it can be proclaimed. That was one of his purposes, that God was doing all of this in Christ Jesus. So we need to do this, live and proclaim the truth of the gospel. Let God work through you, display his power by demonstrating it. Step out in faith, be a witness, live for God, and let him display who he is in his awesomeness inside of your life. How many of you have ever been encouraged and blessed by something God did through someone else? See, that was the wisdom of God displaying through them. And you know what it did to you? It encouraged you. It touched you. It blessed you. It helped you. It drew you closer to the Lord. That's what God wants to do through all of us. The second purpose of this mystery is also something else that Paul reveals in verses 12 and 13. Not only are we to display the wisdom of God, but we are to approach God freely. How many are glad you can come to God by now freely at any time? That's the purpose of it. God wanted to make a way of free access between you and Him 24/7 so that you can come before God, come to God at any time, at all times. We are to approach God freely. The word boldness here means freedom of speech, unreservedness of speech. So Paul says, I've been given boldness, unreserved speech. I can come and pray before God at all times now without any fear of intimidation or hindrance because guess what? My sin has been dealt with. I am forgiven. God has removed that obstacle so that now I can enjoy the love of God, the presence of God, the joy of God. I can feast in His presence and enjoy all that He has. He says we have access. The word access here is a Greek word that literally means a friendly relation to God whereby we are acceptable to Him and have the assurance that He is favorably disposed towards us. Wow, that's a powerful word, access. It means that I have this friendly relationship with God, and I am connected to Him, and I am accepted by Him, and I am assured that He loves me and is favorably disposed towards me. That's the confidence that I have. I have boldness. I have access. It's in Christ and through Christ that we have this free access to God, and we are not to be discouraged by the things that are going on around us. Matter of fact, Paul even mentions this in verse 13. He told this church, he said, I don't want you to become discouraged by the things that I'm suffering. How many know that when you go through hardship, pain, suffering, difficulties, persecution, all that stuff, it can kind of wipe you out sometimes. It can pull you down. And even if it's not you, if it's someone that you love, if it's someone that's close to you, how many know that when you see them going through it, it can also pull you down because what affects them affects us. And so Paul is concerned for this church because he's going through the fire. He's going through hardship. He's going through afflictions and pains and sufferings and all these different things, persecutions happening to him. I mean, the devil's just throwing everything he can at him and he's going through all this. And so Paul writes to this church and he says, I don't want you to become discouraged by what you see me suffering. How many know that God wants to encourage us? He wants to bless us. Paul was concerned for them. No one likes to go through pain. No one likes to go through suffering. No one likes to go through all these hardships. But you know what? Paul viewed these things as part of God's plan for his life and so that he could spread the word of God, spread the gospel, share the word of God. And so let me just encourage you, don't become discouraged when you or someone else goes through things. You know what we need to do? We need to stand fast in the presence of God. Stand fast on the Word of God. Remain joyful. Remain praiseworthy in His, you'll give God praise, exalt Him, maintain that right attitude because, yes, you will go through difficult times in this life. That's because you live in a sin-filled world, but how many are glad that Jesus has saved you and entered into your life? He makes a difference there so that even in the midst of all the things that you're going through, when you're sick as a dog and you can't get out of the bed, how do you know that He's still there and He's still on the throne? Amen. Jesus is there with us. And so we come out of those times and we learn to rejoice and we draw closer to God and see Him work inside of our lives. That's why God reveals this mystery. And this is the purpose of it, so that we can display His wisdom and so that we can come before God at any times. See, there are times where sometimes we sin, we fail God. And you know what the devil wants to do? He wants to make you so discouraged through that you feel like quitting and throwing in the towel and walking away and never going back to church again. Don't ever pray anymore. Because that's what the devil wants to do. That's condemnation. But Paul says, you need to remember something. We have free access. So that all you need to do is go before that throne of grace and find the help that you need right now. Say, Lord, cleanse me, forgive me, I blew it, I said, or whatever. How many know that He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us, the Bible says, from all unrighteousness? Why? Because we have that free access. We have that free access. We can come before God. We can enter into His presence and rejoice before Him. I thank God for the purpose of this mystery. So let's fulfill that. The final thing I want to look at is in the last part of this chapter. And it helps us understand our identity in Christ because not only does God have a mystery, but God also reveals through Paul that there is something about His might and His power that's at work. And this is an exciting thing that I want to preach about this morning. Look in verse 14. Paul says this, for this reason, he's actually praying, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that He would grant you according to the riches of His glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and the length and the depth and the height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be the glory in the church by Jesus Christ to all generations forever and ever. Amen. This is what Paul says, and he prays for this church. And how many know that's a prayer that I believe affects us too? It's a prayer for us. So let's look at what Paul prays here. Because first of all, this is what I'm going to look at. God has revealed how the might of this mystery works. Been preaching and teaching about this mystery. But now there's a way that this mystery actually works in and through us. How many glad God doesn't just tell us something, but God also shows us something. Have you had somebody tell you something to do, but you couldn't quite figure it out, but then they showed you what to do, and it made a big difference? See, God tells us this. He tells us this mystery. He reveals this mystery to us. But not only does God tell us the mystery, he now shows us how this actually works in and through us. And it's by his power and by his Spirit. There are awesome things. I read a story about a 747 jet that was halfway across the Atlantic when the captain got on the loudspeaker and he said, "Attention, passengers, we've lost one of our engines, but we can certainly reach London with the three that we have left. Unfortunately, we're going to arrive an hour late as a result." Well, an hour later, the captain made another announcement. He said, "Sorry, but we lost another engine. We can still make it on two engines. I'm afraid, though, we're going to now arrive 2 hours late." Shortly thereafter, the passengers heard the captain's voice again. He said, "Guess what, folks? We just lost our third engine. But I want to assure you, we can fly with only one. Now we're going to arrive 3 hours late." And at this point, one of the passengers got pretty upset. He said, "For Pete's sake, if we lose another engine, we'll be up here all night." Not exactly what's going to happen there with that power thing, but how many know that God has shown us something, that there is the might of his power that Paul talks about here? That's an exciting thing. So let's look at a couple things. First of all, Paul prays that we be strengthened by the Holy Spirit. Did you notice that in the middle of that prayer, Paul says, "I pray that you will be strengthened with might in the inner man." How? It's through the Holy Spirit. You see, when somebody gets saved, their spirit, I believe, is born again. They're regenerated. They're given eternal life. How? Because the Holy Spirit comes to live and dwell and abide in them. He regenerates them. He revives them. He gives them eternal life. The Spirit of God unites with them, and they become one with him. And there's a spiritual thing that takes place there where God gives them eternal life. And I rejoice with that. But let me tell you something. There's more than just getting the Holy Spirit to live and dwell in you when you get saved. We need to be strengthened with his might. We need to be strengthened with his power. We need to be filled with God's Spirit so that we can be spiritually strong like God wants us to be. I believe that every Christian needs to be filled with the power of God. Seek the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Seek to be filled with God's Spirit. Let it be an overflowing experience, because Paul is praying this. This is not just a theology, folks. This is a prayer of Paul. And if Paul is praying that we be strengthened, then that means it's something to be experienced. How many of you have experienced the Holy Spirit at some point in your life? You experience, like the old timers used to say, the Holy Ghost. Experience the Holy Ghost. Experience his touch, his move, his power, his grace, his anointing. All those different fancy words to say that God's Spirit wants to strengthen you, move in you, do something in and through you. Paul says we need this strengthening. Why? I believe we need this strengthening because it helps us to overcome our fear, our discouragement, our anxiety, our stress. We need God to strengthen us so we can serve the Lord in ministry, so that we can be an effective witness for him, so that we can pray like we need to. How many know that you won't even know how to pray effectively without the Holy Ghost helping you? You won't even know what to say unless the Holy Ghost gives you the words to say when you're trying to witness or to share or whatever. We need the Spirit of God to strengthen us with might in the inner man. We need this power of God. Secondly, verse 17, Paul says, we must let Christ be at home in us. We need to let Jesus be at home inside of our lives. Matter of fact, the word dwell here, where Paul says that Christ may dwell in our hearts, the word dwell means to live in as a home, or to settle down and to be at home. You see, it's one thing to live somewhere, but it's a whole other thing to feel at home there. You know, many of us, sometimes you go visit friends or visit whatever, and they invite you into the house, and different people have different protocols when you come into their house. You know, I had one friend once that had this, I mean, his house was so nice. It was immaculate, and, you know, you had to take your feet, your shoe, I started to say take your feet off the door, but that would not, that would not look too good. But you had to take your shoes off at the door, and that's fine, that's his house. But you know what? I was scared to death that I would mess something up. Because, you know, his house was immaculate. It was perfect. He had no knickknacks sitting around. You know what knickknacks are? My house is full of them. You know, I've got stuff sitting around. Everything you get from everywhere and everybody gives you, you just kind of set it somewhere. You know, you got the house full of them. He didn't do that. You know, he believed in keeping everything bare and just prim and white and just dust, no dust. No, and so you sat down on the couch. You was afraid you might make an indention or something. And, you know, you just didn't feel at home there. You was kind of glad to get out of there because you felt so suffocated that I love fellowshipping with him. We work together actually in the same factory, but it's like, man, I don't know he brought me a cup of coffee. I'm like, I'm afraid to drink it in here because, you know, you just didn't know what to do. I didn't feel at home. But how many know when I got back to my place? Got back to my place. Man, I did kick my shoes off. But I didn't do it at the door. I did it somewhere in the house. And I just probably slung them off, you know, at some point and let it fly and then found it later on. And then I went and got me something to eat. And I didn't even eat at the kitchen table. I went and plopped down on the couch and just turned on the TV and set the drink there. And I didn't even have a coaster sitting. Why? Because I was at home. I felt at home. That's what Jesus wants to be in your life. He wants to be at home. That means he wants to feel so welcome and have so free of an access in your heart, in your mind, in your body, in your life. He can do whatever he wants to, and there's no issue with you. See, we got Jesus in our lives, but many of us have confined him to one room. He wants to be at home because we belong to him. Amen. We belong to him. This is what Paul prays here, that Christ would be at home inside of us. And in order for him to be at home inside of us, that means that we've got to say, Lord, you are Lord. You don't like that? Okay, Lord, I'll get rid of that. I'll stop doing that. This bothers you, Jesus? Hey, let's put that away. Let's stop doing that. Lord, change this thought. Change this attitude. Change this aspect of me. Because I want you, Jesus, to be at home in me. I want you to be able to go where you want to go. I want you to be able to do what you want to do. Get rid of my pride. How many of you know that our pride hinders God more than anything else? We've got to humble ourselves before him and say, Lord, here's my heart. Here's my life. Here, you want to use me, work through me, whatever. You're at home in me. You see, one of the reasons that God wants to strengthen us with might in the inner man is so that we can also couple this together. If Christ is at home in us, then the Spirit of God is free to do powerful things through us. And that brings me to the other thing that Paul prays. He prays that we must know the love of Christ. And this is what we got to do. We must know the love of Christ. You see, it's only when Jesus is at home in us that I believe we become rooted and grounded, Paul says, in love. Verse 18, he actually prays, and the word comprehend, he says, I want you to comprehend the love. The word comprehend in the King James Version should actually be translated to grasp. If you were to take a hold of that pew in front of you and just grasp it, what are you doing? You're grabbing hold of it. You're grabbing it so firm that it's, you know, you're going to be there. Have you ever seen some sinners sometimes that were so conviction that, you know, they needed to come to the altar, but they grabbed a hold of that pew and their knuckles turned white, they were gripping it so hard? I've seen that happen before. It's kind of funny. You're praying they'll submit, but they're holding on for dear life. How many know that we need to grasp the love of God? Grasp it. Hold on to it. Lay hold of the greatness of the love of God because he has grabbed a hold of us. Paul even talked about something similar in the church at Philippi. He said, I want to apprehend. I want to lay hold of that which he has apprehended me. He's got a hold of me. He's arrested me. He's grabbed a hold of me. And I want to grab a hold of what he's grabbed a hold of me for. I need to know this. See, this is how we come to know and experience Christ's love for us and in us. I believe the love of God is a tangible thing. I believe it's something that's more than a theology. I believe it's something that's a reality that we experience because it's God himself. God is love. And this is how we're filled with the fullness of God. Why? Because love is His nature. When I love and I have the love of God in me, then it will come out and flow to other people. Will I be, it's something I have to strive for. It's something I have to open myself up to. It's something I need to pray constantly for. But I need to know the love of Christ that will take me to new levels. And then the other thing that he prays about here is, fourthly, we must let His mighty power work through us. See, I believe that the reason I had to mention these other three things is because we all get excited as Pentecostals and want to jump to the power thing. But how many know you can't get to the power thing unless you get through these other things that I just talked about? You've got to have Jesus being at home in you. You've got to be strengthened with His Spirit. You've got to have Christ be at home in you. You've got to have this love thing going down, because without all that, the power is not going to work like it needs to. We need His mighty power at work in and through us. And this is what Paul prays. I want to read it again. He says, "Now to Him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen." I love what Paul says there. He says, God, our God, can do exceeding abundantly above all that I can even ask or think. I think I can think of a lot of big things. I think. And but you know what Paul says? God can do above that. Stop and think of the most powerful thing that you think God can do. God says, that's nothing for me. Watch this. That's what God says that He can do. But the thing that He says is that His power to do this is at work in and through the church. That we are a part of that. And as I've studied this, I believe this is what Paul is indicating, that this awesome might and power of God that can do all this is at work in the church. That means that God wants to display, getting back to what I talked about with this mystery, He wants to display this through and in the church. We need to believe God to do these things through us, His people. In commenting on the meaning of this prayer, a Greek scholar named Kenneth Wiest once said this: God is able to do for us and answer our prayers according to the efficiency, richness, and power of the working of His Spirit in our lives. This latter is determined by the yieldedness of the believer to the Holy Spirit. Thus, the saint determines what God is able to do for him. In His inherent ability, there is no limit to what God can do in and through the saint, but the saint limits the working of God in and through him by the degree of his yieldedness to the Spirit. That's a powerful revelation right there. You see, with this in mind, we need to seek to be filled with the Holy Spirit, pray in faith, believe God to do powerful things in us and through us, believe Him to change us, to work inside of us, to do something inside of our heart and our character, to make us into men and women of God that are filled with the love of God, and then to display His glory and His might in and through the church and in and through our lives, and say, Lord, here I am. It's Your mystery and it's Your might. Help me to understand who I am in Christ so that others can see this thing through. See, I believe that's what God wants to do with our church and with you and I as people. And if we will humble ourselves and stay before Him, I may believe God will do that. Amen. He'll do it. Would you pray with me this morning? Hallelujah. Father, I thank You and I praise You right now. And Lord, as we come before You in the name of Jesus, Lord, I want to lift You up and I want to praise You and I want to exalt You. Because, Lord, without You, we can do nothing and we are nothing. But, Lord, we're not just without You, we are in Christ. And so, Lord, I pray this morning that the one that may be here that's struggling right now, is going through a difficult time, that's having some hardships, that's just going through some things, just questioning and wondering. I pray, Lord, that You would just show Yourself strong in their life right now. Manifest Your power and Your glory. Lord, I pray right now that You would strengthen us by Your Spirit. Work in us, Lord. Do what only You can do right now. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Church, let's wait on the Lord for a few moments. I want to wait and see what the Lord wants to do by His Spirit. Let's begin to pray and let God speak, let God touch, let the Holy Spirit have His way right now.